بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وبعد، My respected brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This tape is concerning the excellence and principles of the Adhan and the Iqamah. And on this tape, we'll be discussing the linguistic meaning of the Adhan, the authentic hadith pertaining to its excellence, the hukum, or the legal ruling or status pertaining to the Adhan, the sifa, the description of the Adhan, that is how it is performed, the first Adhan before Fajr, and the legislation of saying As-salatu khayrun min an-nawm in that first Adhan. We'll also be discussing, inshallah, if Allah allows, and gives us time and space on the tape, those things that are incumbent for the muezzin, and also the zikr at the time of the adhan. What are the azkar or the zikrs that we have been graced with from Allah, from the example of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? We will also be mentioning some special notes pertaining to the adhan and some of the benefits that we gain. In addition to this, we will be discussing some of the bid'ah of the Adhan, and also some of the weak and forced hadith pertaining to the Adhan. We will add to this tape, in addition to the Adhan, is the Iqamah and its principles, and some key issues. For instance, is it permissible for the woman to call the Adhan and the Iqamah? And also some bid'ah of or religious, sacrilegious innovations pertaining to the Iqamah, etc. The word Adhan comes from the verb Adhana, which is the past tense, Yu'zinu, which is the present tense, Idhanan, which is the verbal noun. Adhana, which is a fi'l madi, which is the past tense verb, in the fourth form, as they say in English. Yu'zinu, which is fi'l mudari', and idhan, or idhanan, which is the verbal noun or the masdar. Also, we have the word أذنَ, which is the second form in the past tense, يؤذنُ, which is the present form, the مضارع, and تأذيناً, or ta'zin is the masdar or the verbal noun. The word azan also has some sister counterparts, which is ta'zin and azin. So we have al-azanu, al-ta'zinu, and al-azinu. A proof or some evidence from the Quran on the linguistic meaning of the word azan is the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Bara', or also known as Surah Al-Tawbah, which is the 9th chapter of the Quran, the 3rd ayah or verse, where Allah says, وَأَذَانٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ إِلَى النَّاسِ يَوْمَ الْحَجِّ الْأَكْبَرِ. And a proclamation from Allah and His Messenger to all men on the day of the greater Hajj. The word Adhan means proclamation here in this verse. And also in the Quran, in Surah Yusuf, verse 70, where Allah says, ثُمَّ أَذَّنَ مُؤَذِّنٌ أَيَّتُهَا الْعِيرُ إِنَّكُمْ لَسَارِقُونَ. Then a crier cried out, O you in the caravan, surely you are thieves. Of course, pertaining to the story of Yusuf in that surah, chapter 12, verse 70. So the word, linguistically, adhan, that is, means al-i'lam. Al-i'lam means announcement or proclamation or crying out or something of the sort. As for the religious meaning of the adhan religiously, the word that is, means a call to inform others with specific words that the time for the salah has begun. And there's a beautiful explanation for this by Imam Al-Qurtubi, the great scholar from Al-Andalus, or I should say from ancient Spain, Cordova, the great scholar of history and tafsir and fiqh, etc., where he said that the adhan, although it has a few words, it covers all the basics of Al-Aqidah, all the essential issues of Al-Aqidah. And it starts out by mentioning or proclaiming the greatness of Allah and pointing to His wujud, His existence, and His kamal, His perfection. And then he says, it also mentions His tawheed, and it also mentions the denial or the negation of ashirk, or of a polytheism with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He has no sharik. And Imam Al-Qurtubi, Hafiz Rahmatullahi alayh, may Allah have mercy on him, goes on to say that it confirms, it makes confirmation of the risala of Muhammad, of the messengership of Muhammad salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. And then finally he says, it calls to at-ta'atul makhsusa, which is the obedience with specific acts, or specific acts of obedience after testifying to Muhammad's messengership, and it calls to prosperity or success, which is an everlasting success, pointing to the return to Allah and the next life that we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us all. Ameen. And then finally, Al-Qurtubi, rahmatullahi alayhi, may Allah have mercy on him, then says, in a manner, this adhan does this in a manner of emphasis and repeats some of what was already mentioned. So this explanation from Imam Al-Qurtubi gives us in a nutshell some of the religious benefits of the word al-adhan. As for when the legislation of the adhan was made, in other words, when was it made a part of the Sharia, there's a difference of opinion. And Al-Hafiz Ibn al-Hajr al-Asqalani, rahmatullahi alayhi, may Allah have mercy on him, he says in his book called Al-Fathul Bari, which is the the most renowned explanation of Sahih al-Bukhari, he says that there's a difference of opinion and that in the year that it was legislated. But the strongest of opinion is that it was legislated in the first year of Al-Hijra, even though there are some who said that it was the second year of Al-Hijra. As for the reason behind this legislation, we have a hadith that's collected authentically and related by Imam Ahmad and Imam Al-Bukhari, that Nafi' related that Ibn Umar radiallahu anhum ajma'een, may Allah be pleased with them all, said that the Muslims in Medina used to congregate and calculate the time of the Salah, and there would be no one who would call them. And they spoke about it and discussing it one day. And some said, we should have a bell like the Christians. Let's use that naquf, like the naquf of the Nasara. And then some others said, no, let's use a buqa, like the qurn of Yahud. Let's have a horn like the horn of the Jews. So Umar, he said, why don't we have one person call the others to the Salah? And then the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, said, Ya Bilal, qum fanada bis Salah. He said, stand up, Bilal, and make the call to prayer. Then we have another narration that says that Abdullah ibn Zayd ibn Abdul Rabbi reported, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam was to order the use of a bell to call the people to Salah, he disliked it because it resembled the Christian practice. And this is something that is very important. This is very important that Muslims should not imitate the kuffar in any way, especially in areas of al-aqidah, of belief, in al-ibadah, in worship, or in the akhlaq, in the moral character, or the behavior, the behavioral characteristics of the kuffar. These three issues are very important not to imitate the kuffar, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam said in a hadith that is the long version of it, is collected by Imam Ahmad with an authentic chain in his Musnad, and in the shorter version in the Sunan of Abi Dawood, also with an authentic chain, that he alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من تشبه بقوم فهو منهم. Whoever imitates the people, then they are of them. So we should be very careful and not to resemble the kuffar in anything that we do, especially in those areas, as we just mentioned, in al-aqidah, al-ibadah, and al-akhlaq, which is belief in worship and in our characteristics and how we behave towards one another. In addition to not imitating the kuffar, we should also try to oppose the kuffar. And the companions were very, very staunch in doing this. Not only did they try, in emulating the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, try to not imitate the kuffar, but they also tried to oppose them. For instance, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would tell us to use the henna on our beard when we have this white, grayish hair on our beard, for the men, that is. And this was to oppose and this to be dissimilar to the kuffar and to oppose them. He also told us to grow our beards, because the kuffar do not grow their beards among the Jews and the Christians. They did not grow their beards. And even if they were to grow their beards, that doesn't mean we should cut them off, because the statement of the Messenger of Allah still stands, and it's not just for that reason that we do these things. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا يَنْتِقَ عَنَ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ, that he does not speak of his own desire. There's nothing but revelation that he's inspired with. So we don't say, just because some of the kuffar wear beards today, whether Jews, Christians, Hindus, or any other type of pagan, that we should cut ours off. No, because if we use that flimsy excuse and principle, then what would happen if all of the kuffar today started making salah? Are we going to abandon it because we want to be different from them and be unlike them? وَلِعَذُ بِاللَّهِ, Allah forbid. So we should take what the Messenger of Allah says, regardless if we understand the wisdom, the deep wisdom behind it or not, and we should just do what he says, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us to do, as he says in the Quran, وَمَا آتَكَمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُ. Whatever the message of Allah gives you, take it, and whatever the message of Allah forbids, abstain from it. So we should try our best not to imitate the kuffar in any way, and we should also try to be dissimilar to them. And a very beautiful example, once again, of this is when Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu, one of the eminent companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, was with Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, who was also one of the top scholars from among the Sahaba of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. We all know that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was above in status Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, even though Abu Musa, as we just mentioned, was an eminent companion of the Messenger of Allah in tafsir and in fiqh and in hadith, in piety. We know that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was over him. In fact, there's a hadith in Muslim on the excellent qualities of the Sahaba that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, without boasting, said, in the company of Sahaba like himself or similar to him, I know the meaning of 70 chapters of the Quran, and I know when they were revealed. I know the meaning of 70 surahs, not 70 verses, but 70 surahs of Quran, and I know when and why they were revealed. And if anyone knew them better than me, I would go get on a fast animal and I'd go straight to him. So this shows that he was eminent and preeminent in his knowledge of Islam and the details of Islam and Iman. So one day, when they were together, and some Jews happened to have been in their presence, and the time came for Salah, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, who at that time happened to have his shoes on, and Abdullah ibn Mas'ud happened to be barefoot. Now we all know from the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the one who is supposed to lead the Salah is the one who has the most Quran, and then if the people are equal in that, then the one who has the most of the Sunnah, and then the one who, if they're equal in that, one who has made Hijra first, and then another narration ending that narration, it says the one who is the oldest. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he definitely had all four categories, and Allah knows best. He beat Abu Musa in all four categories. But on this particular day, when they were in the presence of some kuffar, namely the Yahud, the Jews, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud pushed Abu Musa al-Ash'ari up in front and had him lead the Salah. Why did he do this? Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in an authentic hadith transmitted by Abu Dawood and Al-Bazzar, was an authentic chain, and it was authenticated by Al-Hakim, and Imam Al-Hafiz Al-Zahabi agreed with him in the authenticity of it. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, خَالِفُ الْيَهُودِ فَإِنَّهُمْ لَا يُصَلُّونَ فِي نِعَالِهِمْ وَلَا خِفَافِهِمْ. Which is what? Be different from the Jews, for they do not pray in their shoes nor in their hooks. You see? So the companions would go at any length to A, not be like the kuffar, to not resemble them, and B, to be dissimilar from them. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us like this. So we go on. So when the Prophet was to order the use of the bell to call the people to Salah, he disliked it because it resembled the Christian practice. So Abdullah ibn Zayd ibn Abdul Rabbih, he said, while I was sleeping, a man came to me carrying a bell. And I said to him, O slave of Allah, will you sell me that bell? And then he said, what would you do with it? He said, so I said, I'll call the people to Salah with it. So he said, do you want me to guide you to something better than that? And I said, sure. So he said, you should say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. حي على الصلاة، حي على الصلاة، حي على الفلاح، حي على الفلاح. الله أكبر، الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله. Which of course translates to Allah is the greatest, Allah is the greatest, Allah is the greatest, Allah is the greatest. I bear witness that there is nothing worthy of worship as a deity except Allah. I bear witness that there is nothing worthy of worship as a deity except Allah. I bear witness that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. I bear witness that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. Come to the salah, come to the salah, come to success, come to success. Allah is the greatest, Allah is the greatest. There's nothing worthy of worship except Allah. Then he went a short distance away and he said, when you stand up for the salah, say Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. حي على الصلاة، حي على الفلاح. قد قامت الصلاة، قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر، الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله. When the morning came, he said, I went to the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم to inform him of what I had seen in my manam, in my dream. He said, the Messenger of Allah, I replied to the companion Abdullah ibn Zayd ibn Abdul Rabbih, إِنَّهَا لَرُؤْيَا حَقٌّ إِنْ شَاءَ اللَّهِ فَقُمْ مَعَ بِلَامٍ فَأَلْقِ عَلَيْهِ مَا رَأَيْتَ فَلْيُؤَذَّنْ بِهِ فَإِنَّهُ أَنْدَى. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, your dream is true, it is the will of Allah. So now go to Bilal, tell him what you have seen, radiallahu anhu, and tell him to make the call to prayer, for he has the best voice among you. And so, the companion who was narrating this particular narration, who of course was Abdullah ibn Zayd ibn Abdul Rabbih, he said, I went to Bilal and I told him what to do, and he made the adhan, he made the call to the prayer. And then Umar was in his house radiallahu anhu when he heard it, and he came out with his cloak, and Umar radiallahu anhu said, وَالَّذِي بَعَثَكَ بِالْحَقِّ لَقَدْ رَأَيْتُ مِثْلَ الَّذِي أَرَى. He said, by the one who has raised you with the truth, I saw similar to what he saw. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi وعلى آله وسلم then said, فلله الحمد. This hadith has been collected by Imam Ahmad and Abu Dawood وابن ماجه and ابن خزيمة and الترمذي. And Imam الترمذي says this hadith is حسن صحيح. Now I'd like to take these moments now to clear up some mistakes by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some of the mistakes that many muazzinun, many people who call the adhan, make when they call the adhan. The first mistake that I'd like to mention, and may Allah forgive us all, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, رَبَّنَا لَا تُؤَخِذْنَا إِن نَسِينَا أَوْ أَخْطَأْنَا. O our Lord, do not punish us if we forget or make a mistake. And the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he had mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has lifted from his ummah, he has absolved from his ummah al-khata'u wa nisyanu wa mastukrihu alayhi, mistakes, forgetfulness, and things they compelled to do. So we're human beings and we make mistakes. The first mistake that I'd like to mention is that some Muslims, when they call the Adhan, they say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. The mistake is that we shouldn't put the A sound or the Fatha sound on the end of the word Akbar when we try to join it with the other Allahu Akbar. That is, the statement, the way it was revealed by Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because the Adhan was revealed, is Allahu Akbaru, Allahu Akbaru, meaning Allahu Akbaru, Allahu Akbar. If we're going to join, if we're going to keep it separate, there's no problem. We say Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. But if we're going to join, we should make it with a Dhamma, an U sound, not a Fatha, which is an A sound. The correct way is Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, not Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar is a mistake. That's the first mistake. The second mistake is that some people, they say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. This is a grave, grave mistake. Hasha lillah. This is a very, very grave, serious mistake. Because anyone who says in the Adhan, or in their Salah, when they begin their Salah, or in the middle of their Salah, Allahu Akbar, they're now saying, is Allah the greatest? And one of our Shaykh, the great scholars of Islam of today, Shaykh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen, Habibullah, he said, anyone who says this, Allahu Akbar, which means, isn't Allah the greatest? This is a statement of kufr, and they have not begun their salah. I mean, Allah forgive us. Ameen. And may we correct this. Also, there's another grave, grave, serious, serious, super duper serious mistake that some people are making. They're elongating the ba by putting an alif, an a sound, on the ba of akbar by saying, Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. If you say Allahu Akbar, the word Akbar, instead of Akbar, shortening it, making it short, the word Akbar is the plural word for a word that means drum, a drum, like a skin drum. So if you say Allahu Akbar, you're saying Allah is a set of drums. وَلِعَذُ بِاللَّهِ. You can't say this. Allah is a set of drums. You have to be very, very careful to say it exactly the way it comes in the text. Not elongating vowels that should be short, nor vice versa, shortening vowels that should be long. But we should be very, very careful not to say Allahu Akbar. We don't want to say Allah is a set of drums, because Allah is not created. Drums are created. Allah is the creator of everything. Another mistake that some of us make is when calling the Adhan, some of us say, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. I bear witness that I, Muhammad, is the messenger of Allah. By saying anna instead of anna, anna meaning I, the first person, I, the first person pronoun, personal pronoun. Like you say, anna Muslimun. I'm a Muslim. You know? So we shouldn't say, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. That I bear witness that I, Muhammad, is the messenger, or am the messenger of Allah. We don't want to say this because we're not the messenger of Allah. Muhammad ibn Abdullah, Abdullah is the messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Also, some people make the mistake of putting a kasra on the meem, on the M of the word Muhammad, instead of putting a fatha. This is a very common mistake. Instead of saying, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, some people say, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Muhammad. It's not Muhammad, it's Muhammad. We shouldn't change the meaning. And Muhammad is the passive participle, the one who is praised. And Muhammad means something like the one who is the praiser. The one who is the praiser, It's an active participle. So we should be careful not to change one letter, one vowel sound. We shouldn't say Ashhadu anna Muhammad. We should say Ashhadu anna Muhammad. Another mistake that comes to my mind are people who say Hayyu ala salah, Hayyu ala salah, instead of Hayya ala salah, Hayya ala salah. Another example of a mistake is people who say Hayya ala al-fallah, Hayya ala al-fallah. They put a shadda on the word falah. Instead of saying falah, they say falah. They make it two L's instead of one L. If you say Hayya ala al-fallah, you're saying come to the farmer, come to the farmer. Well, you're on a farm now? What, you're calling people to some agricultural business or something? No, you don't say Hayya ala al-fallah. You say Hayya ala al-fallah without the two L's or the shadda, meaning come to success, come to success. And these are some of the mistakes that come to my mind. Also in the Iqama, some people say قَدْ قَامَتُ الصَّلَاةِ. They put a dhamma on the word قَدْ قَامَتُ. It should be قَدْ قَامَتُ الصَّلَاةِ with a kasra, a ih sound, instead of قَدْ قَامَتُ الصَّلَاةِ. Now some people may think that this is very trivial, and they may say, oh, see there, they're always nitpicking, they're always splitting hairs, every little technical detail, it has to be exactly, come on now, it doesn't have to be exactly like that. But in fact, it does have to be exactly like that. Let me just give you an example. There's a hadith that we find transmitted by Al-Bukhari and Muslim, and you can also find this hadith mentioned in the very precious, auspicious book called Riyadu Salihin, Gardens of the Righteous, by Imam al-Nawawi, in the section, I think it's chapter 7, section Al-Yaqeen and Al-Tawakkul, certainty and putting your trust on Allah. The hadith is on the authority of Abu Umara al-Bara ibn Azib radiallahu anhuma, who said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ya fulanu, إِذَا أَوَيْتَ إِلَى فَرَاشِكَ فَقُلْ اللهم أسلمت نفسي إليك ووجهت وجهي إليك وفوضت أمري إليك وألجأت ظهري إليك رغبة ورهبة إليك لا ملجأ ولا منجى منك إلا إليك آمنت بكتابك الذي أنزلت وبنبيك الذي أرسلت. That this particular dua that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in this hadith, he said to Al-Bara ibn Azib رضي الله عنه, was also known as Abu Imara or Abu Amr. He said, Ya Fulan, oh so-and-so, when you want to prepare to go to your bed, you should say, Allahumma aslamtu nafsi ilayk. And a rough translation of this is, oh Allah, I submit myself to you, wa wajjahtu wajhi ilayk. And I turn my face to you, wa fawwadtu amri ilayk. And I consign or entrust my affair to you, wa aljantu zahri ilayk. And I commit myself to seeking a refuge and shelter to you. رَغْبَةً وَرَهْبَةً إِلَيْهِ. And a rough translation of this is, out of hope and fear. لَا مَلْجَأَ وَلَا مَنْجَأَ مِنْكَ إِلَّا إِلَيْهِ. And there is no shelter nor any salvation from you except towards you. آمَنْتُ بِكِتَابَكَ الَّذِي بِكِتَابِكَ الَّذِي أَنْزَلْتَ. And I believe in your book of which you sent down. وَبِنَبِيِّكَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلْتَ. And then the Prophet, your Prophet, of which you sent. The Prophet ﷺ told him that if he says this and he dies at night, that he'll die on al-fitra, that he'll die in a state of Islam, in complete Islam and Iman. And then if he woke up, he said you would wake up in good. Now the point that we want to make here about that nothing should be changed, not one word, not one letter should be changed, not one vowel, is that one of the narrations which is collected by Al-Bukhari says that Al-Bara ibn Azib or radiallahu anhu, when he was making the du'a, he changed the wording from prophet to messenger. he said, instead of saying وَبِالنَّبِيِّكَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلْتَ, as the Prophet had instructed him to say, he said وَبِرَسُولِكَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلْتَ, and I believe in your messenger in which you have sent. Now we all know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam is a prophet and a messenger, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that he is Rasulullah wa khatib al-Nabiyyin, that he is the messenger of Allah and he's the seal of the Prophet. So he's a Nabi and he's a Rasul. He's a Nabi, a Prophet, and a Rasul. So was he wrong? Of course he was wrong. He was wrong in the sense that you cannot say anything except what Allah and His Messenger has said. Even though it's true, you can't change the wording, especially when it's coming from Allah as revelation. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam corrected Al-Bara ibn Azib by saying, no, don't say وَبِرَسُولِكَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلْتَ, but rather what you should say is وَبِنَبِيِّكَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلْتَ. So this is one of the many, many proofs that we shouldn't change one letter. So if someone says in the Adhan Muhammad instead of Muhammad, we should advise them to change it, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't reveal the word Muhammad. He revealed the word Muhammad, and he didn't reveal Allahu Akbar, he revealed Allahu Akbar. He didn't reveal Ashhadu Anna Muhammad Rasulullah, he revealed Ashhadu Anna Muhammad Rasulullah, and so on. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us all. Also, another mistake, while we're talking about the mistakes of the Azan and Niqama, is that some people, they say, when the Mu'adhin says Hayya ala salah, and then Hayya ala al-Falah, some people say Hayya ala al-Salah and Hayya ala al-Falah after the Mu'adhin, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to say what the Mu'adhin says. But we have another narration where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam said to say, when he says Hayya ala al-Salah and Hayya ala al-Falah, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. There's no strength nor power but in Allah. Now we'd like to move on to some of the excellent qualities of the Adhan. There are some things that we gain from calling the Adhan, and one of the benefits of the Adhan is that it is a means for forgiveness and to be admitted into the paradise. On the authority of Abdullah ibn Umar رضي الله عنهما, may Allah be pleased with him and his father, he said that the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, يغفر للمؤذن منتهى أذانه يستغفر له كل رطب ويابس سمعه, that the Muazzin will be forgiven at the end of his Adhan, and that everything that is wet and dry that hears it seeks forgiveness to him. Allahu Akbar. Also, we have a hadith on the authority of Abu Huraira رضي الله عنه, whose real name was عبد الرحمن بن صخر, and we call him Abu Huraira رضي الله عنه, because this is what his people called him. He used to carry cats, little kittens, in his sleeves and carry them on his shoulders. The word Huraira means a kitten, and this was the name that was given to him by his people. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to call him Abu Hir. Hir is the masculine word for the cat, and Huraira is the feminine word. And the reason why the Prophet used to call him Abu Hir, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam knew that the male is not like the female, and that there is some distinction. So the Prophet used to call him Abu Hir, and he used to also call him what his people called him, which is Abu Huraira, which was his kunya, his nickname. But his real name was Abdul Rahman ibn Sakhar radiallahu anhu, our beloved companion of the Messenger of Allah. He said from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, المؤذن يغفر له مدى صوته ويصدقه كل رطب ويابس. But the Muazzin is forgiven for his sins the distance or as far as his voice reaches. Subhanallah, Allahu Akbar. Nowadays we have these speakers and these microphones. Subhanallah, it's a great reward for someone's voice to carry. I remember living in Medina, the Prophet's masjid, they have these high powered speakers, and you can hear the Azan for at least 2 miles, 3 miles. Can you imagine your sins being forgiven when your voice reaches to that extent? And the other part of the hadith says, وَيُصَدِّقُهُ كُلُّ رَطْبٍ وَيَابِسٍ. And every single thing, anyone, wet or dry, that hears this particular adhan from the muazzin will confirm and affirm and find truthful what he says. And then there's another hadith from Al-Bara ibn Azib رضي الله عنه. It says that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and the Nabi Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إن الله وملائكته يصلون على الصف المقدم والمؤذن يغفر له مدى صوته ويصدقه من سمعه من غضب ويابس وله أجر من صلى معه. He said, Allah and His angels pray upon those in the first room, and the caller, the prayer is forgiven as far as his voice reaches, and whoever hears him will confirm what he says, and he'll get a reward similar to those who pray with him. This hadith is authentic as all of the above hadith, and this one is collected by Imam Ahmad al-Nasa'i and Imam al-Munziri rahimahullah, one of the great scholars of Islam, says that a chain is a good chain, alhamdulillah. And then also Abu Umama radiallahu عنه, he said that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم also said, المؤذن يغفر له مد صوته وأجره مثل أجر من صلى معه. That the muazzin is forgiven for his sins the distance of his voice, meaning as far as it will travel when it is heard, and his reward, his ajr, is like the ajr or the reward of the one who prays with him. Then we have another hadith from Muawiyah رضي الله عنه that he says أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said إن المؤذنين أطول الناس أعناقا يوم القيامة. Subhanallah. And this is collected by Imam Ahmed and Muslim and Ibn Majah, and of course it is authentic. That is, the callers to prayer, the muazzin, the people who say Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, and call the people to Salah all over the world, will have the longest necks of all people on the day of resurrection. And we know from Imam al-Shawkani that this shows the excellence and the superiority of those individuals. It's not a deformity or anything like that. That the person who's going to have the longest neck, and we must believe that it's the longest neck. We don't believe that it's symbolic or anything like that. We accept the message of Allah's statement exactly the way it is, that they're going to have the longest neck. When you see something that has a long neck, it's a gracious thing. It's a very gracious, beautiful thing. So these people will have the longest necks because they are the individuals who call the people to Salah, and this is a sign of those individuals who did so in this dunya, which is a temporary, fleeting thing. And of course, the next life is the best life. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلْتُؤْثِرُونَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى. They prefer the life of this world, but the next life is better and more eternal. Allahu Akbar. Then we have another hadith from the authority of Uqba ibn Amir that he said, which رضي الله عنه, he heard the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم saying, يعجبك ربك عز وجل من راعنا غنم في شغية. That the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, your Lord, the Exalted, is amazed and pleased by one who is watching his sheep in his pasture. And he goes to the mountain to make the call to prayer and pray. Allah the Exalted then says, look at my slave over there who makes the call to prayer and establishes the prayer out of fear of me. I have forgiven my slave and allowed him to enter into the Jannah. Subhanallah. قَدْ غَفَرْتُ لِعَبْدِي وَأَدْخَلْتُهُ الْجَنَّةِ رواه أحمد وأبو داود والنسائي. And it's collected by Ahmed, Abu Dawood, and Nasa'i. And alhamdulillah, this hadith, as we mentioned on the other side of the tape, is alhamdulillah, this hadith is authentic. Then we have some other narrations in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that when the salah, the adhan is called for the salah, shaitan draws near to the individual, I should say, shaitan goes away and he starts farting, starts breaking wind, passing gas. until he can't hear the tezin, which, remember, which we mentioned in the other side of the tape, is another word for the adhan, tezin. And when the adhan was completed, when it's finished, when the mu'adhan finishes it, with the last statement, La ilaha illallah, then shaitan comes back. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, فَإِذَا فُوِّذَا أَدْبَرَ, that when the tasweeb is made, tasweeb here means al-iqama, then he goes away again. And then when the tasweeb is finished, he comes back again, starting to cause problems between the person and his nafs. And then he says, اُذْكُرْ كَذَا, اُذْكُرْ كَذَا, like remember this, remember that, mention this, mention that. In other words, try to remember these things that go on about the dunya while you're making your salah. And then he says, لَمَّا لَمْ يَكُنْ يَذْكُرْ مِنْ قَبْلِ حَتَّى يَظِلَّ الرَّجُلُ مَا يَدْرِي كَمْ صَلَّى. It says, it gets to the point where he mentions those things, he starts thinking about those things before he made the salah, so much so that the person becomes involved in the thoughts outside of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and outside of the things he should be thinking about in salah, so much so that he can't even remember how many raka'ah he prayed. So we have to remember, brothers and sisters in Islam, that what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in His Quran, that إِنَّهُ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ مُبِينٌ, that surely shaitan is for you as an open enemy. Then we have another hadith from the story of Jabir radiallahu anhu, that he said, سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم, I heard the Messenger of Allah saying, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ إِذَا سَمِعَ النِّدَاءَ بِالصَّلَاةِ ذَهَبَ حَتَّى يَكُونَ مَكَانَ الرَّيْحَاءِ, that surely shaitan, when he hears the nida for the salah, the call for the salah, which is the adhan, he breaks away until he goes to a place called الرَّيْحَاء. And the person who narrated, Jabir رضي الله عنه, who was Jabir ibn Abdullah, may Allah be pleased with him, he said الرَّيْحَاء was a place which is about 36 miles from Medina. So shaitan, subhanAllah, Allah causes shaitan to run away when he hears the adhan, about 36 miles. Alhamdulillah, you need to call the adhan all the time. And then we have another hadith from Salman al-Farisi radiallahu anhu, who said, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم, إذا كان الرجل بأرض طيب فحانت الصلاة فليتوضأ فإن لم يجد ماء فليتيمم فإن أقام صلى معه ملكاه وإن أذن وأقام صلى خلفه من جنود الله ما لا يرى طرفاه. Is that when a person is in a wasteland, in a barren land, in a land that, you know, has no life in it, it's an empty, bleak, you know, deserted type land, way out, probably not near any civilization. And then the time of salah comes, then he should make wudu. And if he doesn't find water, he should make tayammum, and then he should establish the salah. He should prepare for the salah. And if he does this, then two angels pray with him. And if he calls the azan and the iqama, then behind him from among the angels of Allah and the jinn, there will be those individuals who will pray with him that his eyes wouldn't be able to see. So we see from calling the azan some of the other benefits, which is that the angels come close to us and they pray with us, and the Muslims from among the jinn come close to us and they pray with us when we call the adhan, and the shaitan, alhamdulillah, he runs away even to a distance of about 36 miles, as is mentioned in the hadith above, and he farts and he tries to disturb us, and we should always seek refuge to Allah from the shaitan. Also, we know that one of the benefits of the adhan is the dua after the adhan is answered by Allah Azza wa Jal. عن أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم قال الدعاء بين الأذان والإقامة لا يرد. And in another narration, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, مستجاب فادعوا. That Anas رضي الله عنه, the son of Malik, said to the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said that the dua between the Adhan and the Iqama is not rejected. In another narration, he said it is accepted. So make dua, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم said. And then from Sahl ibn Sa'd رضي الله عنه, he said رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم said ساعتان تفتح فيهما أبواب السماء وقل وقلما ترد على داع دعوته عند حضور النداء والصف في سبيل الله. That there are 2 hours or 2 time periods, and which in those 2 time periods or 2 hours the gates of heaven are open, and whenever the person who makes dua makes the dua, it is answered, and that is, meaning those 2 times, is when the azan is called and when they are in the rule fighting in jihad, fi sabilillah, alhamdulillah. And also in the story of Abdullah ibn Amr, رضي الله عنهما, أن رجلا قال يا رسول الله إن المؤذنين يفضلوننا, فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما مزيدا, قل كما يقولون فإذا انتهيت فسل تعطى. He said to the Messenger of Allah, that the man said to the Messenger of Allah, O Messenger of Allah, surely the mu'adhins yufaddilunana, they're being preferred and given superiority over us. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, say whatever they say, meaning the mu'adhin, and when you finish, then ask and it will be given. It will be given to you. Also, we know that al-mu'adhinun, as we mentioned in the hadith before, that the mu'adhin will be the longest necks, people with the longest necks on the day of resurrection. Also, we know one of the bounties of the dua is, of the adhan, is that the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for the mu'adhin, that Allah forgive him. For on the authority of Abu Huraira and Abu Umama radiyallahu anhuma, may Allah be pleased with both of them, in a hadith that is called marfu', that is, it goes back to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, الإمام ضامن والمؤذن مؤتمن. اللهم ارشد الأئمة واغفر للمؤذنين. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the Imam is a guarantor, and the caller to prayer is one who is given the trust. So, O Allah, guide the Imam and forgive the Mu'azzin, the caller to prayer. Subhanallah. The Prophet made dua for the Mu'azzin. Also, شهادة الجن والإنس للمؤذن يوم القيامة, that there will be the bearing witness of the jinn and the human being for the mu'adhin on the day of resurrection. That Abdullah ibn Abd al-Rahman ibn Abi Sa'sa'a رضي الله عنه أن أبا سعيد الخدري, that Abu Sa'id al-Khudri رضي الله عنه said to him, إني أراك تحب الغنم والبادية. That Abu Sa'id al-Khudri said to the man, surely I noticed that you love your sheep and you love the open doors of the desert, the open space of the desert. He says, فَإِذَا كُنْتَ فِي غَنَمِكَ أَوْ بَادِيَتِكَ فَأَذِنْتَ لِلصَّلَاةِ, then you call the adhan for the salah. فَارْفَعْ صَوْتَكَ بِالنِّدَاءِ فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَسْمَعُ مَدَى صَوْتِ الْمُؤَذِّنِ جِنُّ وَلَا إِنْسُ ولا شيء إلا شهد له يوم القيامة. وقال أبو سعيد سمعته من رسول الله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه. He said, raise your voice then with the adhan, for surely the scope of your voice, the distance of your voice, will not, of the muezzin, will not be heard by the jinn or the men or about anything except that it will bear witness to him on the day of resurrection. And Abu Sa'id radiallahu anhu said, I heard this myself directly from the Messenger of Allah. Then we have the issue that we know that al-mu'azzinun are the umana wal-muslimin ala salatihim wa suhurihim, that the mu'azzin are the protectors, the guardians of the Muslims. In other words, they guard the Muslims over their salah and their suhur, when they make their suhur for fasting in and outside the month of Ramadan. On the authority of Abu Mahzura radiallahu anhu, and a marfu' hadith that goes back to the Messenger of Allah, where he said, meaning the Messenger of Allah, أُمَنَاءُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ عَلَى صُلَاتِهِمَ صُحُورِهِمَ الْمُؤَذِّنُونَ, that the guarantors or the protectors, the safeguard of the Muslims concerning their salah and their suhoor are the mu'azzin. And we know that this is the case. The reason why is because they're the ones who announce to the people who are going to make the salah that the salah time has come in, and they're also the ones who when the Muslims are about to fast, the mu'azzins are the ones who protect the Muslims by virtue of the fact that they tell them by the announcement of the event that they should stop eating their suhoor. And incidentally, I'd like to just mention that the hadith on the authority of Abu Huraira and Abu Umama that says that the mu'azzin are the guarantors. They are the guarantors. Al-imamu al-dhamin wal-mu'azzinu mu'tamin, that they are, the imam is the guarantors and the call, the one who calls the prayer is given the trust, I should say. When it says that the imam is dhamin, the imam is dhamin, the guarantor, it means that he's given the responsibility for the salah of the people who are following, the ma'mumin. And the mu'azzin is mu'tamin, meaning that he's the trusted individual, the one who is entrusted in keeping the time of the salah, the mawaqit of salah. As for the hukum of the adhan, meaning the legal status of the adhan, the ulama or the ahli al-ilm, the people of knowledge, they differ concerning the hukum of the adhan, and they have quite a few opinions. But the rajih, or the weightiest of the opinions concerning the adhan, with the connected dalil to it, the evidences, is that it has the hukum of al-wujub, that the adhan is fard al-kifaya, or for individuals, and that it is wajib to make it in the masjid for the mu'azzin. And this is one of the evidences for this is the very famous hadith of what the scholars in Islam call al-musi'u salatahu, the one who we should say messed up his salah, the one who kept coming back to the Prophet saying salamu alaykum, and the Prophet saying wa alaykum salam, and then the Prophet kept saying to him irji' fasalli fa in lam takun tusalli, return and make your salah because you haven't made your salah. And finally the Prophet, after he asked him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he asked the Prophet to teach him, the Prophet told him, إِذَا قُمْتَ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ فَتَوَضَّ كَمَا أَمَرَكَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ قُمْتَ اسْتَقْبِلْ الْقِبْلَ ثُمَّ تَشَهَّدْ وَأَقْبِلْ ثُمَّ كَبَّرْ ثُمَّ كَبِّرْ فَإِنْ كَانَ مَعَكَ قُرْآنَ فَقْرَأْهُ وَإِنْ لَمْ يَكُنْ مَعَكَ الْقُرْآنَ فَاحْمَدْ اللَّهَ وَهَلِّلْهُ وَكَبِّرْهُ فَإِذَا رَكَعْتَ فَارْكَعْ حَتَّى تَطْمَئِنَّ. All the way to the end of this important hadith, which is found in the Sahih collection of hadith and mentioned by Imam Al-Hafiz Ibn Hajar Al-Asqalani in his book Fath al-Bari, also in the Majmu' of Imam al-Nawawi. And the hadith basically says that when you prepare to make the salah, when you intend to make the salah, then make wudu as Allah has ordered you, then stand and face the qibla, then you should make the adhan and the iqama, then you should say Allahu Akbar, then you recite that of the, which of the Quran that you have with you, whatever you have of the Quran with you, he told the man, then you recite it, and if you don't have anything, then say Alhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, then you make ruku', And when you make the ruku', make it in a manner that you become tranquil, every bone and every joint falls into its place, all the way to the end of the hadith. So this is one aspect of the evidence of this hadith, is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered the man to make the adhan in his statement, ثُمَّ تَشَاهَدْ. And we know from the principles of usul, meaning usul al-fiqh, the principles of the fundamentals of fiqh, that al-amru yaqtadi al-wujud illa bil-qarina, that a commandment necessitates obligation, as is mentioned, of course, in the book of fiqh, the book of usul al-fiqh, unless there's some other evidences that will reduce that statement of command to something like supererogatory, mustahab, highly recommended, or halal, or something of the sort. There are some other issues that help to support this particular fact that it is obligatory. First is that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he enjoined on the adhan at all times, and the companions, as we mentioned in the hadith earlier, that that even if they were attending to their flock out in the desert, or if they were in a wasteland, and be out of the qi, in a land, a barren land by themselves, that they should be muwazab ala al-adhan, that they should be constant, and vigilant and constant on the adhan, saying it all the time. And this is something that the Prophet did. He always said it, and we have narrations that point to the fact that the Sahaba never ever left off the adhan, and Allah knows best. And this was dictated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the very first days of Islam, as we mentioned in the first year, all the way to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam ad-da'a. Secondly, we like to say that regarding the adhan, that the adhan was a sha'ira, so to speak. It was a sha'ira. A sha'ira meaning that it was a ceremonial practice or a type of worship which would be an indication to allow someone's blood to be spared during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because Anas radiallahu anhu said, أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان إذا غزا بنا قوما لم يكن يغزو بنا حتى يصبح وينظر فإذا سمع أذانا كف عنهم وإن لم يسمع أذانا أغار عليهم. That when the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم and the companions used to go out to an expedition about to attack a people, he wouldn't do it until the morning, and then they would sit and wait. And if he heard the adhan, he would refrain from them. If he heard the adhan, he would refrain. Refrain from what? Refrain from attacking them. And if he didn't hear the adhan, أغار عليهم, he would attack them. So this is extremely important to understand the importance of the adhan, and why the majority opinion, I should say not the majority opinion, but the strongness of the opinion, is that the adhan is on the hukum of wujub, meaning that it is obligatory. As for the description of the adhan, we've already given a description of the adhan, and there are quite a few other ways that the adhan is performed, at least two others, I should say. One is making four takbirs at the beginning and saying the rest of the phrases twice. That is Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, and then saying Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, Hayya 'ala as-salah, Hayya 'ala as-salah, Hayya 'ala al-falah, Hayya 'ala al-falah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah. Of course, La ilaha illallah is mentioned once in the end. And that would make 15 phrases in this adhan. Then the second way that the adhan is called is making the takbir twice. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, and then repeating, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, making the number of phrases 17. And this is collected by Muslim, which is reported by Abu Mahzura radiallahu anhu, where he said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught him the adhan like this: Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Then repeat Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah twice, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah two times, Hayya ala salah two times, Hayya ala al-falah two times, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah. Then the other way in which the adhan is called is similar to the first way, which is making the takbir of Allahu Akbar four times, but then repeating Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah twice and Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah twice. And then when that's done, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, that will be done as the hadith mentioned by the companion that mentioned it, was Abu Mahzura. It says that he would say Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah wa tukhfadu biha sawtu, or he says tukhfadu or takhfidu biha sawtak. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to then lower your voice, then repeat them again in a louder voice. So it will be Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, and then in a low voice, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, then Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, and then a low voice, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, and then repeat it again in a louder voice. And Abu Mahzura radiallahu anhu said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught him an adhan consisting of 19 phrases. And this is collected by Tirmidhi and others. And this is the three ways that we know of from the scholars of Islam based on hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that we can call the adhan. So if we hear somebody calling the adhan like this, we shouldn't be get bent out of shape and get all upset and say that the person is committing bid'ah. But in fact, this is the adhan as legislated by Allah and transmitted by his messenger, and this is something that we should submit to, because as one of the great people of the Salaf, one of the great people of the past, of our rightly guided predecessors, they said, وَعَلَى اللَّهِ الْبَيَانِ وَعَلَى الْرَسُولِ الْبَلَاغِ وَعَلَيْنَا التَّسْلِيمِ, that on Allah is the explanation, meaning the message of Islam, and the explanation of it, and on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, on the messenger, is the conveyance of it, and on us is just submission, that we should just submit. Then we should move on to the aspect of the adhan, which is al-adhan al-awwal qabla al-fajr wa mashru'iyyatu at-tathwib fihi, the first adhan before fajr, and the legislation of saying as-salatu khayrun min an-nawm in it. We know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated the first adhan before the fajr, and this is approximately 15 minutes before the actual time of fajr comes in. We have the authentic hadith that is collected by Imam al-Bukhari and Imam Muslim, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam companion said that inna balala yu'adhinu bilayli or بِلَيْلٍ أَلَّيَرْجِعُ قَائِمَكُمْ وَيُوْقَضُ نَائِمَكُمْ فَكُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا حَتَّى يُؤَذِنَ إِبْنِ أُمَّكْتُمْ, that surely Bilal is the mu'adhin for the night, so that you can return to your standing and you can wake up your sleeping. So eat and drink until the individual called Ibn Ummaktum, the Sahabi of the Messenger of Allah, whose name was Abdullah ibn Maktoum, the same individual who asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to allow someone to go with him and lead him to the Salah at night because there were scorpions in the road and he didn't have a person to lead him because he was blind. He's the same individual whom the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam found and turned away from in the verse of Quran where Allah says, عَبَثَ وَتَوَلَّى أَنْ جَاءَهُ الْأَعْمَى. He frowned and turned away when the blind man came. This is the same individual. His name is Abdullah ibn Maktum رضي الله عنه. That the Prophet ﷺ said, eat and drink until Ibn Maktum calls the Adhan. So this is a proof that Bilal was not, number one, was not the only Mu'azzin of the Prophet ﷺ, as some people in their nationalistic, Afrocentric fever and zeal would try to make people think that Bilal was the only Mu'azzin of the Prophet ﷺ, exclusively from everyone else. And number two, it's also a proof that Bilal was the one who would call the Adhan approximately 15 minutes before the actual time of Fajr came in, of which the scholars of Islam call, based on authentic hadith, Al-Fajr al-Kazib, the false Fajr. He used to call the Adhan so that people who were making Qiyam al-Layl, the night prayer, Taraweeh or Tahajjud, in or outside of Ramadan, could stop making their Tahajjud and get ready to begin the day for fasting or begin the Fajr prayer. And also Bilal's Adhan, radiallahu anhu, Bilal ibn Rabah, the great companion of the Messenger of Allah, that his Adhan was also to tell the people to stop eating their suhoor, to get ready to stop, and also for those individuals who were intimate with their wives, to get ready to stop being intimate with their wives, and also for those people who are sleeping. And that's why in Bilal's Adhan, he used to make Tasweeb. It's called a Tasweeb. A-T-T-H-A-W-E-E-B. A-Tasweeb. It means to say, As-Salatu Khayrun Minan Nawm. As-Salatu Khayrun Minan Nawm. It means prayer is better than sleep. Then, approximately 15 minutes later, when Al-Fajr al-Sadiq, that the true Adhan, the true Fajr would come in, then Abdullah ibn Maktum would call the second Adhan, which is actually the first Adhan, because Fajr now actually comes in, and that lets you know, no more sex, no more eating if you were going to fast, no more Tahajjud because Fajr is going to come in, and you should have already been awake for the Salah. And this is extremely important to understand, that this is not just in Ramadan. This is inside Ramadan and outside of Ramadan. And we'd like to make a special note for those Muslims here in America who read the book Everyday Fiqh. There's a section that I remember reading years ago in this book. I can't remember if it's the first volume or the second volume, but it's on the section of the Adhan, that it says that when the Mu'adhin says As-Salatu Khayrun Minan Nawm, that the people should say Sadaqta wa Bararta, that they should say something roughly to the fact that you have spoken a statement of righteousness and you have spoken the truth, or it is righteousness and truth. And this, brothers and sisters in Islam, is an unauthentic hadith, that we should not say this when the Mu'adhin says As-Salatu Khayrun Minan Nawm, prayer is better than sleep. We also know from other narrations that for someone who may ask, well, how did Abdullah ibn Maktum know when the event, when Fajr came in, if he was blind? And I would say to a person who would ask this question, Anta Shatir, you're very intelligent, or to the sisters, Anta Shatira, that you're very intelligent and you're smart, because this is a very, very important question. And the answer to this, and Allah knows best, is that, as the Prophet ﷺ's companions mentioned in hadith, sahih, an authentic hadith, that when Fajr came in, they would say to Abdullah ibn Maktum, Asbahta, Asbahta. Fajr has come in, or morning has come in, and then he would call the Adhan, without As-Salatu Khayrun Minan Nawm. Prayer is better than sleep. Prayer is better than sleep. Now we'd like to mention some of the things that are incumbent upon the Mu'adhin. Some of the characteristics and attributes, qualities that the Mu'adhin should have. One of the things that the Mu'adhin should keep in mind is that he's calling the Adhan for the faith of Allah, and that he should be doing it to get the reward of seeing the face of Allah, and also to acquire his pleasure, and he should not be getting paid for it. Because we have hadith of Uthman ibn Abi al-As radiallahu anhu, that he said, I said, Ya Rasulullah, ij'alani imaman imama qawmi, O Messenger of Allah, make me the imam for my people. And then he said, Anta imamuhum, that you are their imam. Waqtadi bi adha'afihim, he said, be careful about the weak among them. This is what the Prophet was telling him sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. Be careful about the weak among who? Among them. And then the Prophet said, وَاتَّخِذْ مُؤَذِّنًا لَا يَأْخُذُ عَلَىٰ آذَانِهِ أَجْرًا. And he said, and appoint a caller to the salah who doesn't accept raises, who doesn't accept cash, money for the adhan. This hadith is collected by Imam Ahmed, it's extracted by Imam Ahmed, and his Musnad, and Abu Dawood, and Nasa'i, and Al-Hakim, and also can be found in the very famous book, Al-Irwa'u al-Ghalil, by Sheikh Al-Muhaddith Al-Alama, Muhammad Nasruddin Al-Albani. This hadith is number 1492. Also, we have some other narrations from the companions. Narrations from the companions are called Asar. Asar. And the singular for that word is Asar. Asar. Which is a narration from the Sahaba or the Tabi'un, their students. That a man came to Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, and he said, Inni uhibbuka billah, I love you for the sake of Allah, or I love you for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fashhad alayya inni abghaduka billah, and you should bear witness from me that I hate you for the pleasure of Allah. And then the man said, Walina? He said, why? And then Abdullah ibn Umar, one of the Sahaba of the Messenger of Allah that was so tenacious and zealous in following the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so tenacious that he used to follow the Prophet in things that we didn't even have to follow him in. He used to follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, memorizing his footsteps, and he made hajj. He's also the same individual who, when he saw the Messenger of Allah urinating, he memorized that place that he urinated. He said, you know why I'm urinating here? Because the Messenger of Allah urinated here. It's the same Abdullah ibn Umar. He said, when the man said, why do you hate me? He said, لِأَنَّكَ تُلَحِّنُ فِي أَبَانِكَ وَتَأْخُذُ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا. And this hadith is sahih. That you sing the adhan, you make talheen in your adhan, and you accept payment for it. So from this narration, this athar from the Sahaba, we learn two things. Or we learn at least three things. Number one, that we should not be calling the adhan like this. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. We should not be trying to sound like Luther Vandross or somebody, some singer out there in the street when we call the adhan. Unfortunately, وَلِيَعْضُ بِاللَّهِ Allah forbid that we get like this. But there are some Muslims around the world who are now calling the adhan the Nasheed Islami, the Islamic song. May Allah forgive us. Ameen. And the second thing that we learn from this hadith, or this athar, this narration from the Sahaba, is that it's not permissible to take money for it. And number three, which is really important, is that you see how strict and how zealous and tenaciously sticking to the sunnah the companions were, that they, even though they were very close to someone, if they did something that was in, if someone did something which is in contradiction to the book of Allah, the Quran, and the sunnah of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in contradiction or in opposition to the way of as-salaf as-salih, our rightly guided predecessors, meaning the Sahaba, they would dislike people for this. They would hate people for doing anything that was in opposition to the book of Allah and the sunnah and the way of the salaf. And this is in total agreement with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions in the Quran. By Allah's statement in the surah called Al-Mujadila, which is chapter 58, verse 22, after saying, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, لا تجد قوما يؤمنون بالله واليوم الآخر يوادون من حاد الله ورسوله ولو كانوا آباءهم أو أبناءهم أو إخوانهم أو عشيرتهم أولئك كتب في قلوبهم الإيمان وأيدهم في روح منه ويدخلهم جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار خالدين فيها رضي الله عنهم ورضوا عنه أولئك حزب الله ألا إن حزب الله هم المفلحون. الله سبحانه وتعالى, there is the English translation, that is, you won't find the people who believe in Allah on the last day loving those who oppose Allah and His Messenger, even though they be their fathers or their sons or their brothers or their clan. As for such, He has written faith upon their hearts, and He has strengthened them with a spirit from Him, and He will bring them into garden, this Jannah of Allah, the paradise under which with rivers flow, wherein they will abide. Allah is well pleased with them, and they are well pleased with Him. They are Allah's Hizb. They are the Hizb of Allah, the party of Allah. Surely, is it not Allah's party who are successful? And by the way, I'd like to mention something. You notice that I said, after saying, A'udhu Billahi Min Shaitan Rajeem, that Allah says something. One of the mistakes of some of the scholars of Islam, and they are human beings, they make mistakes, and some of the mistakes of the Talibatul Ilm, the students of knowledge, and of the Du'at, the people who give da'wah, Du'at is the plural word for a da'i, is that they say in their khutbahs or in their wa'ab, their exhortations, or in their speeches or their lectures, they may be quoting a verse from the Quran, and they say, Allah says, A'udhu Billahi Min Shaitan Rajeem. This is a big mistake, because Allah doesn't say, A'udhu Billahi Min Shaitan Rajeem. You shouldn't say this. We should rather say, A'udhu Billahi Min Shaitan Rajeem, that Allah says, and then quote the verse. But we shouldn't say, Allah says, A'udhu Billahi Min Shaitan Rajeem, then recite the verse. This is just a point that is a very subtle point, but Shaitan likes to get us in all types of things, even when we're trying to do good. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best.